Welcome to Dan's On Fandoms. I'm Dan. Episode 4 of The Bad Batch has dropped, and this was another fun one. I mean, how can you not like an episode with Fennec Shand in it? I think this episode served three purposes. One, showing fans that The Bad Batch are low on supplies and credits and need to figure out a way to make money, and how are they going to do that? As mercenaries, of course. Two, hammering home the point that the Empire is moving extremely fast to place their stranglehold upon the galaxy. And three, it's not the Empire looking for Omega, but rather the Kaminoans. So let's start with the main impetus of this episode, which is that not only are the Bad Batch low on supplies, since the Republic was responsible for providing them with their supplies and provisions, but Echo also learned that the Bad Batch are now on an Imperial wanted list. This then prompts the Bad Batch to stop on the planet Pantora to resupply and work on adjusting the Havoc Marauder signature. A starship signature is what allows authorities or others to identify a ship. By scrambling their signature, they'd be able to conceal their identity from the Empire or even bounty hunters. Once the squad landed on Pantora, a greasy Sullustan notified Fennec Shand that an Omnicron-class attack shuttle just landed on the planet, the same ship the bounty hunter is looking for, as we learn that there's a bounty out on Omega, which who put out a bounty on the young girl. I have some thoughts on that we'll get to shortly. Back to Clone Force 99, who decided to split up. Tech and Wrecker stayed at the spaceport to work on the Havoc Marauder so that its signature can be scrambled, while Hunter, Echo, and Omega went searching for supplies. En route to find supplies, Hunter, Echo, and Omega see that the Empire organized a parade in honor of the Clone Wars ending, and we even see the lovely broadcast of Admiral Rampart talking about the newly created chain codes, the same broadcast we saw in Episode 2. We got to see just how jubilant and happy the citizens of Pantora were now that the war is over, and how willing they are to support the decline of the Republic and the rise of the Empire. Even Omega mentioned that the war being over is a good thing. One of my favorite things about the prequels and the Clone Wars was that both did a really good job at showcasing how Sidious slowly chipped away at the Republic and manipulated pretty much everyone into supporting the rise of the Empire. A harrowing reminder that the rise of totalitarian governments are sometimes fully supported by everyday citizens, just like Nazi Germany. At one point, Hunter even mentioned how quickly things are changing in the galaxy, which has been very noticeable in the previous episodes. Sidious wasted no time at all in placing a vice grip around the galaxy so that his Sith Empire could thrive, and getting galactic citizens to approve and take part in the rise of the Empire only made that stranglehold more tight. As Hunter, Echo, and Omega moved on, they soon came upon a merchant who doesn't want to buy Hunter's munitions, so he has to resort to scamming the merchant by selling him Echo, whose ballin'-ass outfit made him look like a droid. Essentially, the Bad Batch have very few means to make credits, aside from utilizing their military and fighting prowess, and potentially resorting to dealing with the black market, which the merchant even mentions to Hunter when Hunter tried selling his pyrodetonant explosive. I liked how Echo felt he was worth more than 2,000 credits, and got the sale price up to 3,000 credits. You do you, homeboy. Between this scene and the scene later on, where Echo removes the restraining bolts from the merchant's droids, we're seeing that central theme of this series, which is freedom, choice, and having the agency to live and do things as you like. With limited options, the Bad Batch are refusing to be controlled by the Empire, and are choosing to resort to scamming a merchant out of credits, hinting at what's to potentially come for the group, and our homegirl Fennec Shand probably also gave them some ideas on how to make credits as well. This is showing us how they'll soon have to use their skills to earn credits, resulting in them becoming mercenaries. Alright, so let's switch gears now and talk about Fennec Shand, who's hunting Omega and nearly captured the young girl after a bounty that's been placed on her. The episode never revealed who put the bounty on Omega's head, but it has to be the Kaminoans. Why would Tarkin and the Empire care about a young girl that has done nothing wrong aside from traveling with the Bad Batch? So it has to be Lama Su and Nala Se wanting Omega back, and most likely this is due to their conversation last episode. We learned in episode 3 that the Kaminoans are worried Rampart and Project War Mantle will make clones obsolete, so they want to fabricate some kind of elite or special clone for the Empire to use, which would hopefully allow the Kaminoans to continue to be needed by the Empire. To do that, they need a new source to obtain genetic material from, since Jango Fett's genetic material has degraded and is no longer really viable to make clones from. I speculated that the Kaminoans will be creating a Force-sensitive clone, possibly someone like Galen Marek. Whatever they're planning to make, it sure seems like they need genetic material from someone who's Force sensitive. We've gotten some clues that Omega is not only special, but that she very well may be Force sensitive, and it appears that genetic material or blood from a Force sensitive being is needed to create a Force sensitive clone. This is something that has been hinted at in Season 2 of The Mandalorian, with Moff Gideon seeking Grogu for his high midichlorian blood, as well as in The Rise of Skywalker, and even in the most recent issue of Greg Pak's Darth Vader series. I think all signs are pointing to Omega being Force sensitive, and it appears the Kaminoans need her blood and or genetic material to create some kind of Force sensitive clone for the Empire. Time will tell what the Kaminoans have planned, and I can't wait to see what those long-necked bastards are up to. A few other takeaways: how heartwarming is Omega? It's awesome to see how excited and amazed she is at basically seeing everything for the first time since her entire life prior was spent on the dreary world of Kamino. I also enjoyed seeing her get to see a Vorpak for the first time. These little critters' fur first appeared in the film Solo, but Vorpaks were more prominently featured in Star Wars Resistance, as Tora Doza had a pet Vorpak named Buggles. And how about my homeboy Wrecker, who wanted so badly to rescue Omega? Wrecker and Omega need to be protected at all costs. All in all, this was another really fun episode, especially after I sat with what happened and processed it. I'm guessing the next episode or two will show the Bad Batch beginning to work as mercenaries, and I'm really looking forward to seeing that. But what do you guys think? What's your thoughts on Cornered? Let us know down in the comments. If you like this video, please help out the channel by hitting that like button and making sure you subscribe. Follow the channel on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook, all at Dan's on Fandoms. Thanks for watching, and stay nerdy.